we can see that we've added the icon library here, and you can see the shopping cart that we added into the project is now rendered here correctly. So if I click on it, it's going to show me all the icons I have in the project. Hey there, welcome to part 2 of building a remix application. In the last part, we've covered the basics, we've added the remix dev tools, and I've also added an icon library plugin. And I said that we'll be tackling icons later on. Well, this is the video that we're gonna do it in. So today we're going to add scripts and icons. And what we're gonna do is do some cool tricks that allow us to confirm the execution of the scripts, plus add icons with a minimal footprint on size as possible. So without further ado, let's just do it. Alright, so let's pick up where we left off last time. So if you remember, I said that we will need to add some stuff here in the icon library component in order for it to work. So what we're gonna do here is, first of all, we're gonna set up scripting. So if you don't know, scripts are anything you put inside of your scripts, inside of your package.json. So these execute by you running them manually. And how you can do that is, for example, if I want to run the dev script, I just run npm run and then I say dev. If I want to run another one, I would delete this and say lint or start or type check or whatever. But there are some use cases for scripts that we can make better. The first thing I'm gonna add here is I'm going to add a command called run scripts, and I'm just gonna paste in the command I've already prepared. What this does is it tells Node to use experimental specifier resolution as Node, and then I use a custom loader from loader.js, and this is relative to the package.json. So we're gonna create a loader.js file, and inside of the loader.js file we're going to paste this config in. And I've already prepared this config ahead of time. Basically, it allows you to do the following. So for example, if I want to import some module from, so now we have a path alias here. So for example, something like this. And this won't work with ECMAScript modules. It works with CJS properly, but for some reason, TS Node and generally this whole approach has some issues with ECMAScript modules. So this is kind of a workaround for it. Hopefully in the future this will be easier to do, but for now I just use this loader, and this allows you to use alias imports so you can run your scripts more easily. You can go through this code if you want, but I'm not gonna go through it because it's just a workaround for something that's supposed to work anyways. We have this ready here, and what we're gonna do with this is we're gonna add another script called script. And what this is gonna do is it's going to run npm run scripts, and it's going to run a script from our scripts/setup.ts file. And because this doesn't exist, let's create it now. So we need a scripts folder, and we're gonna add a setup.ts file inside of it. So I'll be using my own file that I've created for a blog tutorial. I'll be linking the blog tutorial somewhere in the video. What I do is I create a custom setup file, and inside of it I add some simple things that allow me to run scripts with confirmation and with injected environments. So I'm just gonna copy the code from the article and paste it in, and we'll quickly go through it together. We can see that I'm missing this, so I'm going to install the dev dependencies that I need. So I'm going to need the following. I'll need chalk, I'll need dot environment, and I'll need prompt. So child process comes from Node, so you don't really need to install that part, but the other ones you do. And I've added the dependencies now, and now I think I need to add types here as well. Yeah, I do. So I'll just copy this command here, I'm just gonna paste it in, I'm gonna run it, and it's going to add types for prompt. It's ready. So now let's go over what this actually does, and let's first save this. And what this does is, if we go to the bottom, so when you run a script from your package.json, it's going to execute this file first. And if you go to the bottom here, you will see that it either runs main or runs the confirm run and then runs main. And what confirm run does is if you give the confirm flag to the process arguments, it's going to ask you to confirm this before you run it. Otherwise, it's going to run it right away. And what main does is it's a fancy wrapper that allows you to inject environment scripts, and it also does some checking for us to check if the name of the script starts with this and then runs it from this folder, otherwise runs whatever you want. So you can either run scripts from this folder or run some custom scripts from third-party packages like Prisma. And you don't really need to know what all of this does. If you want to, I'll link the article so you can read in detail what it does. But for now, we're just gonna save this and we're gonna go back to the package.json here. And now that we have these two scripts, we can use these to run any script we want. And why we've done this is so we can use this to run the icon script. And what we're gonna do is we'll allow Copilot to help us here, and we want to run this script. But because we now have this, we'll replace this run scripts here with script. And we're gonna remove this because our script automatically picks this up. And what we're gonna do is save this. And because this is a little bit confusing, I'll rename run scripts to execute. So what this is gonna do is, whenever we run icons, it's going to run our setup script, and then it's going to execute it. So this will execute the script, and this will tell us that it executes the setup file first, and then runs this file. And I actually need to add the scripts part here, so it knows that it's the script folder. I shouldn't have removed that. And if we save that, and go to our scripts and create icons.ts file, I've already prepared a script that I want to run, so I'll just add that in as well. And if I go to the top here, and I also install as a dev dependency node HTML parser. And now if you look at this, what this is gonna do is it's going to read from resources icons folder, which we're gonna create right now. So we created the resources folder, and now we're gonna create icons inside of it. And we're going to be adding icons there. And the output path is app library icon icon. So we're gonna create that right now. So we're going to add library to the app. We're going to create an icon folder inside of it. It's going to output it to the icons here. So what this does is it creates an SVG element and uses all the icons and transforms them into stripes. And if you want to know how this works, I'll link to an article from Jacob Paris where he explains in depth how this works and how you can optimize icons. This generates this. So an SVG with symbols as definitions, and then you can use these symbols inside of your app to have one SVG only inside of your whole application, and then this generates the types for it. And this might seem a little strange, but if I save this and I create an icon component, so I'll add icon.tsx here, and I also create a folder for the icons. And what I'm gonna do inside of this file is add the following. I'm going to add this icon component, and I've already prepared this, but let's go over it quickly. I first need to add the utilities here. So I'm going to add the CN utility from shared CN UI. We're gonna create a utils folder, and I'm going to recreate a CSS.ts file here. So inside of here, what we're gonna do is we're gonna create a CN utility, and basically takes in class value arrays. It gives it to CLSX, which merges it into a single string, and then tailwind merge merges the tailwind classes, which helps with merging some classes that conflict each other. If you, for example, have text large and text medium, they're gonna conflict, and tailwind merge helps with that. And we're gonna import all of these, and that part is ready. And now if you go back here, the only thing that's missing is this, but this will get generated by our script, and we save this. Alright, so what we're gonna do now is we're gonna add some icons into our resources icons folder here. And I've added a shopping cart, And whenever you add icons, there are important things to note. The first thing is, if you want them to work with any height and width, you have to delete these properties. And then fill and stroke can usually stay here, they don't really impact anything. So we're gonna remove these, we don't really need classes because we don't use them. And whenever you pick up icons like these, it's a good idea to check if they have predefined fills and strokes here. If they do, you would have to remove them because they wouldn't allow you to change colors with your icon component. And we're gonna save this and we're gonna run yarn icons. I just use yarn because I don't like writing run. But before we do that, let's first install TS Node as a dev dependency. And then we're gonna run yarn icons. And as you can see, it loaded the environment from dev, which is the .environment file that we don't really have, so this didn't do much. Oh, so this failed because dot is not recognized as an external command. So this is because I wrote it like this instead of like this. So if I run it again, we can see that it generated the sprite for resources icons. And if we go to our icon script, you can see that it says generated sprites for here, which means it ran successfully. And if we look at the icons folder, we can see two things. It generated the icon SVG file, and inside of it we have our symbols that we just saw that I talked about. And then we have our types. This will be the icon name and the icon name array, and this will allow us to basically type the icon component. And now we can go over what the icon component actually does. So the first thing we have is the icon size that allows us to pick sizes. So these are the sizes. You can add more if you want or remove some of them. These are some of the props I've added in. So you can have a class name, but this extends the SVG element. So you can add more things, but the important thing is that the name is the icon name generated by our script. And the size is the size of these icons here. And what we get in the end is we get this icon component. So it takes in these props, it passes it to the SVG here. We already set our custom props here. We set the fill and the stroke to current color. We set it to inline block so it can be inlined with text. And we set the flex shrink to 0 so it doesn't shrink unnecessarily. And then we can also pass in class names that get merged with C and helper. And then inside of here we say use href sprite href plus the name of the icon. And what this is gonna do is it's going to go into this and then it's gonna say, okay, use this SVG and find the sprite that has the icon of the name that we passed in. And now what we can do is go to our icon library. We're going to import RDT plugin here. And then we're going to go scroll down a bit and replace this plugin with RDT plugin here. The types are a bit old and we don't really want this. And we are gonna remove this as well. So these are gonna be icon names that we've already generated. So actually, we can just delete this and use these instead. And then instead of this icon component here, we're gonna delete it. We're gonna say icon props from the library. We're gonna import the icon from the library itself. And because this requires you to have a check icon, this type will complain because it doesn't exist. So we will just change this to shopping cart for now. And if I do this, it's going to auto suggest the name because it's typed. And we're gonna remove this. And also here it requires the camera, but we're gonna also change it to shopping cart. And we're gonna remove this and this, and we're gonna save it. And then if I clear the console, and actually now that I've thought about it, we don't really need this RDT plugin here. This doesn't need to be typed. And we're just gonna go back and we're gonna delete this type as well. We're gonna save this. And then if we run our project again and we go to the browser and we open up our dev tools, we can see that we've added the icon library here, and you can see the shopping cart that we added into the project is now rendered here correctly. So if I click on it, it's going to show me all the icons I have in the project, and if I add a new one, it's going to be rendered next to this. I can click on it to copy it to my clipboard, and then I could also paste it, for example, in my project. It's going to generate the same thing I would need to basically paste it in anywhere. And if I wanted to add some custom styles to it, so let's say I wanted to change the background of this to red, I could say background red 500, and it's going to change. And one thing to keep in mind is this adds the classes, but if they are not in your style sheet, they're not going to be applied. So if they don't exist in your project, they're not going to be running. And that's it. We've added icons to our project, and we've added scripting capabilities. And what these scripting capabilities allow us to do, if I go back to VS Code, if I go to package.json, I can add, for example, prod. And let's say we have a script that generates icons in production. So let's say npm run script, and then I say scripts slash icons.ts. And let's say I don't want to run this in development, I want to run this in production mode. And let's say I want to confirm it as well. So these are special keywords. So the confirm shows you the confirm dialog, and then the prod argument allows you to say I want it to run the production environment file. And if we run this script, so if I close this and then I clear it and then I run prod, it's first going to say we're about to execute in prod environment, are we sure? And it already loaded our environment from environment.prod, and if we say yes here, it's going to execute our command. If we say no, it's not. And that's it. These are not as powerful right now, but when we add databases, it's going to allow us to basically see different things, and we're going to be able to confirm migrations and stuff like that without having to do much. We just need to add another argument to the command, and we're gonna be able to change a lot of stuff. And this can even be useful, for example, if let's say we wanted to run a Prisma Studio, we would be able to do something like add a script that says studio, for example, and then we say npm run script, and then we say we escape it first, and then we say Prisma Studio, for example. And then we can do something like npm run studio, and right here say production. And if we have the production environment set up, it's going to open up the studio with the production database. And I think it's obvious why that could be useful. And that's it for this part. We've gone over scripting, we have icons in our project, and we can run some custom scripts. And we're ready to move on to greater things. And that's it for today. What we've done today is we've added scripts that allow us to confirm actions that we want to run. They allow us to inject environment variables into scripts that we want to run. And then we've added icons. So the reason we've added icons with SVG sprites is because of the size. They are really small in size, and they allow us to add a single SVG to the page, and then we can also preload it in our project that we're gonna do in the next tutorial, and we're gonna speed up the SVG generation by a ton. As I've said, this is supposed to be an interactive series, so if you have any questions or have suggestions for improvements, or you want to change something, feel free to let me know. We can discuss it in the comments, and I'll also include it in the next part. And that's it for today. Thank you for watching, and see you in the next part. Bye!